Illinois, they have been staying in our education building the last few days as they're on mission trip, and they're here with us this morning. Welcome to all of you. We are having our going away. There'll be a dinner on July 9th after worship in honor of Meredith's departure as she is moving to Nashville. I was going to say in celebration of Meredith's departure, but that would be wrong. We're going to be celebrating her ministry here and noting her departure on that day. And we're going to shower her with cards that day as well. And there are a number of announcements in the bulletin for you to take note of. And also on June 24th, which is next week, there's a cookout at Skip and Stephanie Petrovsky's house, and information on that is found in the bulletin. Let us take time and center ourselves for worship with music.
Stand-up routines or camp backtracks. The
comedy is something so extraordinarily good that it's hard to believe that the something out of the ordinary that we laugh until tears stream down. It's what Frederick Buechner called high comedy, the high comedy of Christ that was close to tears, but great glad tears at last, not sad tears. Tears at the hilarious unexpectedness of things rather than the loss of hope.
Thank you.
was a TV repairman. That's how he made his living for many years. And when I was growing up, he used to go on service calls at night a lot of times to supplement the income. And one of the cool memories I have was he used to take me with him. So I got to see my dad repair all sorts of televisions. And you know what I know about repairing a television? Nothing. And besides anything I would have learned back then, this was in probably the early 60s, everything I would have learned back then would not be worth it now because televisions were completely different. But you know what the best part of the whole thing was? I got to do things with my dad. And it was just the opportunity of him caring enough that he would always have one of us tag along. And me being the oldest, I got to tag along first, and I got to tag along for the longest of everybody. I like to say because I was the coolest of all the kids, but that wouldn't have been the case. But I remember learning a lesson that one of the things he always did was he took us on service calls, he took us to the store, just to be company with us, and just so that we knew he loved us. And I remember when my kids were little, I would take them to the store, and every time I went to do something, I always took one of them. This was my way of showing love the way my dad showed it to me. So one of the things I learned about being a parent is, it's not just what you say, it's the example you set, and the things you do. And sometimes there's no more precious gift than actually being with our kids. And now as I'm older, and my kids are grown, and they've both moved out of the house. You know what? Every time I get together with them, I still like it just as much as when they were little. But now they don't give us cookies at the grocery store anymore. Let's pray. We thank you, God, for the time you give us, and thank you for the gift of love, which is the foundation of all of our lives. Amen. John Brindle is going to give a dinner scholarship.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Kinderman Scholarship.
Let me bring a little bread that you may refresh yourselves,
and after that you may pass on, since you have come to your servant. So they said, do as you have said. And Abraham hastened into the tent to Sarah and said, make ready quickly 3 measures of choice flour, knead it, and make cakes. Abraham ran to the herd and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to the servant, who hastened to prepare it. Then he took curds and milk and the calf that he had prepared and set it down before them. And he stood by them under the tree while they ate. They said to him, where is your wife Sarah? And he said, there in the tent. Then one said, I will surely return to you in due season, and your wife Sarah shall have a son. And Sarah listened at the tent entrance behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in age, yet it ceased to be with Sarah that after the manner of women. So Sarah laughed to herself, saying, after I have grown old, and my husband is old, shall I have this pleasure? The Lord said to Abraham, why did Sarah laugh and say, shall I indeed bear a child now that I am old? Is anything too wonderful for the Lord? At the set time I will return to you in due season, and Sarah shall have a son. But Sarah denied, saying, I did not laugh, for she was afraid. He said, oh yes, you did laugh. Today's message, Dr. Manzo, called Great Beginnings in the Fertility of Hospitality, will now be given.
Of course, we're going to welcome new members of the congregation. I would invite Ben Bradley Rogers, apologize for being involved this last name, to come forward, and Ashley Morris and Ken Rose, and invite the 3 of them.
Let us welcome the newest
always, O God, be aware of your ability to do the unexpected in our midst. The little boy was very excited. He learned about the childhood of his hero, George Washington, in school, and heard the story of young George Washington chopping down the cherry tree. His dad asking him if he indeed was the one who chopped down the cherry tree, and young George Washington saying, "I cannot tell a lie. It was me." The little boy went home and wanted to chop down the cherry tree in the worst way. He couldn't find any cherry trees, but all the other trees were way too large. This was a long time ago in a very rural area, and the little boy was searching for the cherry tree, for a small tree to chop down. But he finally saw an outhouse sitting on the side of a hill. So the little boy took his axe and chopped away until the outhouse went careening down the hill. The little boy was filled with joy and happiness. That evening, his father came home, and his father was bruised and angry. And he walked up to his little son and said, "Did you, son, chop down the outhouse sitting on the side of the hill?" And the little boy said, "Dad, I love George Washington, and like George Washington, I cannot tell a lie. It was me." The dad said, "I thought so. Up to your room. You're grounded for a week." And the little boy said, but Dad, George Washington's father didn't punish him when he chopped down the cherry tree." And the father said, "Maybe not. But George Washington's father was probably not sitting in the cherry tree when he chopped it down, right?" Father's Day is one of those complicated days. Some people are blessed with dads who are great parts of their lives, and that is awesome. Many of us have dads who are no longer with us, and we mourn their passing. And there are many who have fathers who are maybe in their lives or not in their lives, and fathers who haven't connected very much with their children. And sadly, if there's going to be a bad parent, it's more likely to be the dad than the mom. So Father's Day for many people is something of a mixed bag. And it's a day that is often very confusing in the hearts and minds of men. Which brings me to a person in the Bible who gets called the father of many generations, Abraham. And the story is almost so strange it's comical. The backstory is this. In Genesis chapter 12, God calls Abraham out of the blue to leave his homeland and all of his kin in order to go to a land that he, Abraham, had never seen. And God makes a threefold promise to Abraham in chapter 12. First, that Abraham would have many descendants and would become a great nation. Secondly, that Abraham and his descendants will inherit the land of Canaan. And third, that they will be a blessing to the whole world. All of which sounds really good and is the foundation of much of who we are right now as a people of faith. But there is a problem with the scenario as laid out in Genesis 12. Abraham and Sarah have no children. We don't know much about anything before Abraham in chapter 12, but we know this. Sarah is not able to have children, and she's also around 90 years old. It's really hard to be the ancestor of a great generation if you don't even have one child. And a theologian once said in regards to this story, infertility is hereditary. If your parents don't have any children, you won't either. So three visitors come, and Abraham and Sarah provides hospitality to strangers, and he is, and his family are the only ones saved in the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. The Bible tells us that Egypt provides hospitality to the Israelites and is blessed. Then they enslaved their visitors, removed the hospitality, and endured God's wrath. In Matthew 25, Jesus reminds us, when we help the least of these, we help Jesus. Hospitality, welcoming the stranger, is a theme that is repeated over and over and over again in the Bible. And in this instance, we learn about the fertility of hospitality, and in this instance, literally the fertility of the hospitality. Were blessed by God. And it's a theme that is repeated over and over again. We learn and grow in faith through the spirit of hospitality, and that is God's way. Second aspect of the story, and sort of the theme, Father's Day struck me with this, is that parenting is the ultimate act of hospitality. When we welcome children into our lives, we welcome them all the way. We share our lives with them in deep and significant ways. Years ago, I attended a lecture by M. Scott Peck. Scott Peck was a psychiatrist, and he wrote one of the most amazing books I've ever read, entitled The Road Less Traveled. And he was giving a lecture, and he said at one point in his life he was fascinated by the writings of an author named Ayn Rand, an author and political philosopher who had the thought that human life is based upon what she called objectivism, which is that the primary goal of one's life on earth was to pursue one's own happiness. Rand did not believe in God, and she believed that being charitable was a way that actually hurt themselves and hurt others. She adamantly did not believe in charity. She would not approve of our church because we worship God and we serve the less fortunate. Peck said he found her work to be fascinating until he thought about children and having children, and he said her ideas to him that he said popped like a balloon. The air went out of it immediately. Parenting, he said, when done properly, is an ultimate act of generosity, of charity, and hospitality. It's going all in. As parents, when we go all in, we're getting it right. There's no way to be an effective parent and only do it halfway. This is not to say that people who aren't parents aren't capable of ultimate acts of generosity, of charity, and hospitality. But one cannot really be a good parent without doing these things. And that goes with both fathers and mothers. And we yield the fact that on Father's Day, it still is, as I said, a mixed blessing for so many people. Hospitality. Hospitality is the act of welcoming all people as we would welcome Christ. Matthew 25 teaches this, and through the many centuries of both the Hebrew Scriptures and the New Testament remind us over and over again. And Abraham sets the example of welcoming strangers into his home and offering them hospitality. The book of Genesis is about great beginnings of faith. Last week we reflected on God's magnificent creative power. Today we reflect on how we have the ability to respond to others. When we live lives filled with the generosity of spirit, of charity towards others, and hearts open to hospitality, we are walking in the path that God invites us to walk. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Swisher. Janet John is still home recovering from surgery. Reagan Schneider is going to have surgery tomorrow, so keep her in prayers. Sandy Hooper's sister, Carol LaSalle, passed away, so we pray for all of their family. Dana, Mike, Noah, and Carter Wright are, Dana is still dealing with her foot, but it says thank you to all the people who have been praying for her and bringing food, and it was very, very nice that she sent out to us. Let's also remember Steve Scalise and all the people who were shot in Arlington, Virginia the other day, that their recoveries might be going up. I read that his condition was upgraded from critical to serious. Which saying that somebody's in serious condition is not good, but it's better than critical, so hopefully he recovers well. Seven sailors, I believe, were killed in Japan. And Ken Rose, who is our newest member, our new members that served in the Navy for 16 years? 16 years and actually served on that base, so that base is close and near and dear to his heart. So we prayed for their families. Also the people who lost their lives in London in a horrible fire, because we don't know how many people have died. The death toll right now is 30, but there are considered to be hundreds of people still in that building. And the building is still fragile, they don't know if they're ever going to get in there. So, a lot of places and people to pray for. Other needs you'd like to pray for those. Yes? Okay, Susan's having surgery on Tuesday. Yes? Okay, your grandson's having back surgery. 22nd? Yes? Your niece Amanda's having back surgery also, but she was the victim of a shooting. Right. Yes? Phyllis, your friend Phyllis continues to recover from the fall. Yes. Your father-in-law Joe Drury is having recovery.
And this is personal, but after trudging around Europe for 10 days, my daughter
parish yesterday. So we're always happy that you're here. And if you want to talk about tired, shrugging faces, say it's one of them. Yes.
Remind people that next Sunday at 9:15 we'll be sending off our youth on their mission trip.
Okay. Yes, we are sending off our kids next week at 9:15 in the parking lot. They're going on a mission trip. And there's going to be another group coming, staying just overnight on Saturday night, and they're leaving for a mission trip. They're staying here, they're going to connect with people, and they're going to be on a mission trip in Mexico. So it's really cool to see youth groups go on a mission trip. And with our short summer vacations, it's sort of everything happens quickly. All right, let's pray. Almighty God of all creation, we join our voices to praise you today, singing of your wonders, giving thanks for your grace and care, and celebrating the joys of life you have blessed us with. Family and friends, new relationships, deeper relationships, great lives. On this day, we are especially gifts of fathers, the fathers who love us so much and who we love, the fathers we miss. We thank you for the many ways those fathers who have been good have shaped us in the example of their love. But we also pray for those who have painful relationships with their fathers, those who are estranged from their fathers, and most especially fathers who estrange themselves from their children. We pray, O God, for those who are able or unwilling to accept the joy, but also the responsibilities of being a parent. Come before you, O God, and we ponder all the important things of life. We come before you and pray in silence for all of our own needs. Let us pray these prayers in the name of Jesus who caused the pain. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power,
we live lives of blessed people and often filled with gratitude. I find myself filled with gratitude for today's the air conditioning works in the sanctuary. And I find myself in gratitude that we're still able to come over here in good spirits here and pray that it gets fixed next week. If not, we'll go next door next week. But that's a whole other story. But I pray that sometimes we get filled with gratitude and sometimes we get upset along the way. But let's always keep grateful hearts and remember that even when there are missteps along the way, God is still God and we're still God's people and still incredibly blessed. So God's generosity is so great. Allow us to share our generosity.
Thank you.
Sarah and Abraham, learning of their unique new beginnings, having their first child at the age of 90, hard to believe, yes, humorous, yes, intimidating also, yes. But as Christians, we need to have the faith that with you as our God, anything is possible. You won't give us anything we can't handle. Let our faith grow and lead us to appreciate all the gifts you have given us, and that we use our gifts to make your kingdom here on earth the best it can be for everyone. Amen.
I invite everyone to turn and commission each other. Let us go forth into the world in peace.
Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord. Rejoice in the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound in the high voice.